All right. So I'm Michel. I'm working at the interface between machine learning and neuroscience. And from two perspectives. So both working on the way machine learning tools can help analyze neuroscientific data. And from the perspective of how learning theory and problems in machine learning are related to problems in neuroscience, like subject memory or perception. So more at the conceptual level. And one connection between these two aspects is causality, actually. And I think you had a lecture on causality from Joris Muij last week. So actually today, I will talk a bit about some application of causality, a particular kind of causality. So essentially, nowadays, there's a special time for machine learning, especially since the deep learning tools emerge and show very good performance on some data sets. And it's interesting that they are more and more replicating what, to some extent, we could consider as human-like types of activities. And in some data sets, they can beat humans at object recognition, all these kind of things, or playing games. There's still quite a bit of questions about deep learning, why it works, and sometimes why it doesn't work. For example, you might have heard about adversarial issues, adversarial attacks on deep learning classifiers. There are some issues with interpretability, and also to understand to simply how they work. From the side of neuroscience, it's also an exciting time, actually. There has been major improvements in experimental tools, but it's still actually we can gather more and more data, but it's then more and more difficult to make sense of it because we are faced with high dimensionality of the data, and interpreting high dimensional data, it's actually a key issue that I would say the concept of interpretability, actually Isabel Valera is gonna talk about it, I think, tomorrow. It's still something that is work in progress. So it's still not clear what is a good concept of interpretability, and especially in high-dimensional data. So as a consequence, there are major questions that remain unsolved in neuroscience, especially those that require to have to exploit essentially the high dimensional properties of brain activity. So there's a connection between the two fields since the very beginning, actually, we'll say. And in particular, if you look at artificial neural networks and deep learning approaches are essentially artificial neural networks, very similar to those that were defined a long time ago. And so some of these principles have been inspired by early discoveries in brain research and in particular physiology. And so I already say that some approaches in deep learning actually close to human performance. But still, we are still in the situation where humans typically do not need such a large amount of labeled data to reach good performance. And if you look at the development, for example, of children, they show very strong generalization abilities without, again, label data. It's pretty amazing. So it's likely that there are still like major improvements to do from the side of machine learning, especially on the side of unsupervised learning and generalization learning for from few labeled data. So I will address a bit what are the similarities and differences between computations in brains and state-of-the-art artificial neural networks. I will also address the question to some extent how neuroscience and machine learning can help each other facing these new challenges. So for today, I will talk about relationship between these two types of networks, biological and artificial. I will afterwards talk about two major brain functions and their neural correlates. So mostly today, related to these two brain functions, I will provide some connections to causality as it is used in machine learning. And I will leave, I think, the big questions and theories still open problems for tomorrow. So let's see how far we go today. So artificial neural networks, I think we can say this started in 1943 with this paper of Warren and McCulloch, from McCulloch and Pitts. So, yeah, 43, it's really a very long time ago. So what they did is essentially exploiting results about the physiology of neurons that so neurophysiologists started already to gather some results on the structure of biological neurons. They found that they could somehow abstract some properties of biological neurons and consider them as elementary logical the elementary tools to compute logical functions. And so this paper is actually very theoretical. You have to take into account that at that time, the field of the so-called cybernetics really was integrating tightly the artificial side and the biological side, to some extent. They were progressing a lot together. And so, yeah, they were inspired by these neurons and say, okay, well, actually, if we we can build some networks with these neurons, and we can compute with them arbitrary logical propositions. And so at that time, Turing machines were also was also a concept that appeared to address questions about computability. And essentially, this paper showed that if you use a recurrent network of such neurons, you can compute in finite time any problem that can be solved by a Turing machine. So to some extent, it was a big thing connected, like the computer and the brain, to some extent. So of course, real biological neurons, they are not exactly logical operators. But yeah, that was a first like physiological Turing machine. So let's go a bit into the more details about the structure of these biological neurons. So here you see, many of these pictures actually are from the book from Diane and about theoretical neuroscience. Huge book. And most of the introductory chapters are still relevant. So you see complex arborization. And essentially on the top, you have what is called the apical dendrite. That is the input part of a neuron. So essentially, it's going to collect postsynaptic currents. So there are synapses that are that essentially connect to the, to this dendrite, and the currents then propagate to the soma. So essentially, the center of the cell that is here. So depending, there are many varieties of neurons, and I mean, typically the arborization can have like some long-range arborization, the apical dendrite, typically will integrate activities that come from remote areas, for example, because of course those cells are distributed all over the brain. And there are also some basal dendrites that typically will collect connections that are more local. And all these are integrated essentially in the soma, and the soma has functions like a threshold. So is essentially depending on the integrated currents. If this integrated current, the total current reaching the soma passes a threshold, then the neuron is going to spike. So this can be measured with electrophysiology tools. And in particular, what's relevant is the membrane potential of the cell. So essentially, the membrane potential is the difference in voltage between inside the cell and outside the cell. Okay, so of course this membrane potential can have different values along the cell. And so typically if you record here from the soma, you will see at a relatively fine time resolution this kind of pattern. So this pattern, there are two types, two components, let's say, in this pattern. There is a slow signal, and that essentially reflects the current, the postsynaptic currents that are integrated across the dendrites and that are reaching the soma. And you see that when this potential is high, then what is triggered is some very fast activity called an action potential, and typically the action potential is a very fast phenomenon that in a short time let a lot of ions cross the membrane, such that the charge difference between the input and the output changes. And this very sharp change, because the nerve cell, the membrane of the nerve cell, is an excitable system, this spike is going to propagate. And is going to propagate along the axon here, that you can see here, that is essentially the output part of a neuron. Okay, so essentially, there is a division in those components of a signal between something that reflects the integrated input and the output, that is the spike. And you see there's a difference in nature also between these two. Like one is a continuous signal, I mean typically smooth signal. We call you also call it a subthreshold activity, because essentially it's the activity of the neuron that doesn't pass the threshold, and it it's somehow some internal variable of the neuron because it's not going to be transferred like the spikes are transferred. So there's a division between this internal variable and the output, the information that is sent. And this information that is sent is, to some extent, binary. Okay, it's more than binary in the sense that it's actually a point process, so it's still a continuous signal. But you see that the information carried by such signal is of a very different nature. So, cell membrane and ion channels. So, if we look closer into like a piece of dendrite, for example, so you get you cut essentially this cylinder, and if you zoom in, you can see essentially. With microscopy methods, these ion channels. So they are essentially the molecules that allow the functioning of the cell. Those have the ability typically to open or close depending on many contextual variables. So they can open or close typically depending on the membrane potential, so the difference of potential between the inside and the outside. And they also can depend on some molecules, for example, like neuromodulatory neurotransmitters, might essentially bind to such big molecules such that the molecules changes shape and opens or closes. So this essentially empowers a neuron with possibly very complex computational abilities. And of course, this is a big issue in neuroscience. Is actually this level can be studied in quite some detail. You can imagine that you can collect these cells, you can study them in vitro, and you can characterize very well their functioning. But then, if your description goes in complexity, it's going to be more and more challenging to figure out what are the consequences of such properties at the system level. So there's always a trade-off between like how simple should be my model so that I can derive and possibly simulate some properties at the system level, given after that I would typically need to generate activity from millions of these neurons. And at the same time, there might be some properties that can be critical at the system level and that should not be missed. So that's really typically a problem for complex systems, right? So this functioning can be described actually by a relatively simple circuit. So you can look at the relationship between, for example, a current that you inject through the membrane and the voltage and so possibly some other parameters. And this leads to the description, if you want to have a very fine description of the activity of the membrane, possibly to do simulation, it's possible. You will typically have three types of elements. You have a capacitance here, C, that reflects the fact that there's a difference in potential between the inside and the outside of the neuron, and there are charges, right, that can accumulate at the surface of this lipidic membrane, and this creates a capacitance, so it has the ability to accumulate charges and modulate the potential depending on the current. It also has what typically people model as resistance or leak conductance. Conductance is just the inverse of the resistance. That models essentially all these ion channels for which you just assume they are linear, meaning like the current that goes through the channels is proportional to the difference to the membrane potential, okay, up to some constant here, and so that typically models the channels that are not very critical to the functioning of the neurons, and you have all these other channels that can be voltage dependent. So here, of course, this introduces a level of complexity in the functioning of the neuron. So this level of complexity, for example, generates the ability to generate action potentials. So there will be ion channels at the level of the soma that when they pass, when the voltage passes the threshold, they're gonna open widely, and then a massive amount of current is gonna pass, and then they're gonna close also very fast due to some other nonlinear mechanisms. So they are generating the spike to some extent. Another type of conductance is the synaptic conductances, and synaptic conductances essentially they reflect also ion channels, but those ion channels essentially they collect the ions that are generated at the level of the synapse, and the synapse essentially can control the opening and the closing of those ion channels. So that means that in this circuit, the input is going to be those synaptic conductances that are modulated by the input in a possibly complicated way. then there is some internal dynamics. Typically, this capacitance and this resistance in parallel, they have the ability to filter essentially the input signal. So you're gonna be able to smooth the synaptic inputs that are collecting across the dendrites. And after that, this integrated input is gonna be able also to control whether the neuron is gonna spike or not with these elements, okay? So people use that to do like very fine computational modeling of such neurons. So you can also acquire essentially the shape of such neurons. So we have actually databases with a huge amount of shapes for these neurons. And typically we can simulate how the synaptic input propagates to the soma and generates some activity. But of course, there are some computational limitations. If you want to simulate a network with thousands of these cells and modeling the activity across all the cells, then you're gonna have you're gonna require massive computational resources. Okay. So what happens in terms of propagation from the synapse? So you see here this the synaptic input. So this belongs to the presynaptic neuron. So this a neuron that is an input to the neuron that we are considering. And there's some complex molecular mechanisms. There's a release of neurotransmitters, and these neurotransmitters are going to trigger the activity in the target neuron. And yeah, this is called the connection here is called dendritic spine. So there's a lot of like these little bags of dendritic spines around the dendrite, And you see the activity propagating. So if you look at the membrane potential at the level of the input, is a sharp peak in the what is called the postsynaptic current. So massive amount of charges enters the neuron, and then is going to propagate to the soma. And then due to the propagation in this medium, this is going to be attenuated, and the shape is going to be modified. So that means that, I mean, this attenuation and this modification of the shape, typically, they are modulated by the properties, the geometric properties, for example, of the dendrite. So that means that a signal, an input that will come much closer to the soma will have a different behavior. And this is also an aspect that can generate complexity in the operation that you can do by combining multiple inputs, essentially, for the neuron. So, and typically doing different kinds of pseudo-logical operation or arithmetic operation. So this has been used in the past for some neurons. So here we can introduce essentially what we're going to call the synaptic weight for an artificial neuron. Essentially, that is this value up to some multiplicative constants, WK here. This is essentially the effect of the input, the neuron K, on the soma of this cell. And people that study plasticity in neurons and learning, they will quantify this quantity. So this is actually called the postsynaptic potential, but you can do interventions here, right? So you can stimulate the input and measure the amplitude of the output at the level of the soma. And with that, we can study essentially learning, right? So if you make some tasks that will trigger learning, or do some changes in the network that will also trigger learning, what happens is properties of the synapse can change. And for example, there are some receptors here that receive the neurotransmitters released by the synapse. And the quantities of these receptors, they can change across time. And this is one aspect that will be able to modulate essentially the W. And so this is the mechanism behind learning in a biological neural network. So in the end, like, you can use this weight to compute a simple static model of a biological neuron that will have these weights, synaptic weights, collected in a vector. So, and you apply essentially to each synaptic weight a binary input reflecting whether, like, one particular input neuron is spiking or not. And you can compute a scalar product here. So here I put the equation. And this is essentially summing the product of these things. So of course, only the neurons that spike will have a value 1. The other will have value 0. And so this total synaptic current reaching the synapse will reaching the soma will be able to trigger an output spike depending whether this quantity passes a threshold, okay? And the threshold is represented by this variable B, okay? So membrane potential is essentially summarized by this quantity, and if this passes the threshold, you get an output spike, okay? So this is 57. And typically, you can see that this neuron is very close to neurons, units that are used in modern deep learning architectures. The only difference is that here we have a hard thresholding. Okay, so typically, this is called a heavy side function takes value 0 for negative quantities of that and 1 for positive quantity. If you change this function and use a smooth function, either a sigmoid, like it's used, for example, for some output neurons, or rectified linear unit that essentially will, instead of one here having something proportional to the input, then you get the model of an artificial neuron. So to some extent, there is a good connection at this level between the two. So what about the learning? The learning, here you can see what I described earlier, a typical experiment you can do in neuroscience to measure plasticity. So typically here we are talking about long-term potentiation and depression. So these are changes of the weights, the synaptic weights, that are long-lasting, potentially long-lasting, like for many days or even years. And so the experimental protocol that you can use is, here you have a structure that is called the hippocampus. I will talk about it a bit more later. You can essentially stimulate in this input structure, CA3, an incoming neuron that has a synaptic connection with this red neuron. So we are just focusing on the blue and the red. And we can stimulate electrically this axon. Then it's going to trigger a postsynaptic potential in this neuron, and this postsynaptic potential can be measured also at the level of the soma of the output neuron. And depending on the stimulation protocol, people have since long observed that, for example, depending on the frequency, if you use a high frequency or low frequency, you can have different types of modification of the synaptic weights. And so here is an example. Here you stimulate with low frequency for 10 minutes. And these are the measurements, essentially, of the postsynaptic potential. So the difference between this value and this value. And you see here that you have a long-term depression after this stimulation. So slow stimulation has triggered long-term depression. And fast stimulation, here 100 Hz electric stimulation of the input, triggers long-term potentiation. Okay, so you have some things here that last relatively long. So typically, these studies are easy to perform in simple architectures where you have like a feed-forward network. And they are the basis of current knowledge about plasticity. In cortex, so this is, let's say, a structure slightly below cortex. In cortex, we have more complicated circuits with a lot of feedback, and such experiments are more challenging to perform. So there are still a lot of unknowns on how exactly learning works, even at this level, at the level of a small network of neurons in the brain. okay, so synaptic, so the properties just mentioning, like we know some mechanism that can trigger these changes in plasticity, and in particular, there are these two types of synapses to such neurons with different types of receptors. Those are called AMPA and NMDA. And essentially, AMPA receptors, the synaptic weights for such channels can be for such receptors. So essentially, it corresponds to the number of ion channels or to the density of ion channels that you have at the level of a synapse. This can be modified by another channel that also essentially receives the input from input neurons. And when some calcium enters, essentially, through this channel, depending on the the modification of calcium concentration that enters by this NMDA receptor, the cell, there are some mechanisms in the cell that are going to be able to produce or eliminate some of these channels. So they are, again, like if you go to the to like a finer level, there's also quite a bit of complexity and molecular mechanism that are able to control the amount of this molecule at the level of a synapse. And this is also a huge field, actually, in neuroscience, in molecular neuroscience. Okay, so these are the biological details. Now, after there are some relatively simple learning rules that have been inspired, essentially, by early work and are still relevant to some extent. Hebbian learning is one of them. So is one of them, I mean, I would say the most well-known and one of the earliest. And simply the Hebbian learning rule says the changes in the weight is going to be proportional to the rate of change to the product of the postsynaptic activity and the presynaptic activity. So essentially, depending on the product of the activity of the output neuron and the activity of its input. And this is an elegant rule and simple enough to understand what it implies in terms of connectionist learning rule. So essentially, it means I will put more weight on an input that spikes when I'm spiking myself, such that, you know, if I'm spiking, essentially I'm trying to relate to reinforce the connection to the neuron that spiked and triggered my spiking. And there is a temporal sophistication of this learning rule that's called spike time dependent plasticity, and that has been measured experimentally, and that introduced some notion of causality, actually, saying, well, actually, I will reinforce a weight of ascribed to one input only if this input came before I spiked. If the input came after I spiked, then I didn't need this input to spike. So I can just, just essentially consolidate the weights for the input that spike before I spike. But for those who spike after, I will just decrease the weight because I didn't need them. So I'm not gonna waste this information. Okay. So. Related to plasticity, essentially there's a fundamental difference between what can be done in artificial neural networks and what can be done by biology. And this has also some relevance for potential VLSI implementation of artificial neural networks, is that essentially these plasticity rules, mostly they have to be local. So a neuron is, so it's a cell, so it's a relatively simple element that has access to very limited information. So when I'm a neuron, the only thing I have access to is my inputs, some vague parameters related to the environment where I am, so essentially potentially some neurotransmitters in the brain tissue. Where I'm located, and the output, so whether I'm spiking or not. And typically with these inputs, I have to decide if I imagine, you know, I'm a neuron as an agent and trying to contribute to my brain, essentially, how can I be useful for the brain where I am? Essentially, I have very limited information to know that. Input, output, and neuromodulators. So, what is called credit assignment, in particular in supervised learning, is a challenging problem. So it's how can I have these plasticity rules to reinforce actually useful connection, but useful at the system level and not just at the level of the neurons. And this is a largely open questions, open question. There is one assumption that we exploited in some work is that we can exploit neuromodulatory activity to encode some rewards for the neuron and try to find out what kind of behavior we can implement with simple plasticity rules and based on these modulators. So neuromodulators, they are a system level control of brain activity. So for now, I have explained mostly like what are the neurons' input and outputs within their network, but they are actually controls that affect neurons in a wide range of brain regions. And you see here essentially the control centers of this neuromodulatory input. These are small nuclei of neurons that are actually located deep in our brains. And they modulate our overall activity, whether we are tired, whether we want to sleep, whether we get excited, motivated by something. This will be controlled by these centers. Some neurons here are going to spike, and those long-range connections to the cortex, they are going to release neurotransmitters in brain tissue. And those neurotransmitters, they are also able to modulate different aspects of individual neurons in overall the brain. So to some extent, you have three controls. You have two controls. You have the controls of the synaptic inputs, so to a particular cell, but you have also this more general control of subcortical neuromodulatory center, and the difference between them is that one is very specific. Okay, I have just a subset, a very small subset of all the brain neurons that connect to me, and at the same time, I have this vague information that is sent not only to me, but also to my neighbors. So a specific and a non-specific input that but this non-specific input, it reflects some information that is significant at the system level. Whether I'm tired or not, motivated or not, is really relevant for our activity at the system level. So one way to study with machine learning tools how this information can be exploited is to define a model, a model neuron that will be sensitive also to this information. So we call this the selectron in this work. So the selectron essentially has the same functional form as the classical perceptron. But the classical perceptron that I mentioned before, essentially it's learning rule. You can train it with an Hebbian learning rule that essentially will adjust weights independently on number of neuronality activity, and also doesn't have this relation to spiked and dependent plasticity, that is going to update the weights only when it spikes. So here, this rule is makes sense biologically because of two aspects, and this rule also from a machine learning perspective. In order to understand the plasticity rule, the nice thing about the machine learning approach is that you don't start from how the weights are updated, but you start from the objective. And especially you can define an objecting function and say, okay, what is my, what do I want to optimize? So I'm a neuron, I'm a function. I want to optimize essentially a loss and I will, I want to choose the weights such that I'm doing optimally with respect to this loss. And then we can go to the next level, that is, what is the algorithm that I need to implement in order to do that? So here we define a reward function. And so you see this reward function has three terms. And one is this neuromodulatory information. So is gonna act multiplicatively. One is the selectivity that adds the biologically relevant term, that is, this function is the Heaviside function here. So it tells you this reward gets some non-zero value only when the neuron spikes. So if I don't spike, I don't change my weight, because essentially, whatever is happening, first is not my business, and second, because essentially I didn't play a role in what happened, I received some input, I also don't have, according to STDP rule, I don't have a biological mechanism to update my weights. So in addition to that, you can have this margin term, and this margin term essentially tells you how strong was your total input current. And so essentially you get a big reward if this quantity is positive. So of course in a supervised setting, you could have like positive and negative quantities for this reward. But you could also have simply an unsupervised setting where this quantity stays positive, for example. And here, this function, so notice that this function here is a Heaviside function, and this term is the same as this term. So given this is a Heaviside function, do you know what is this kind of function? Do you know the name of such function? Do you have a name for such function? Mapping this quantity to this overall quantity? So, I mean, there are two, I guess there are two names. I mean, some years ago, you could say a hinge loss. That is a function, the name that is used for support vector machines. Nowadays, you could call it ReLU, okay, rectified linear unit. Why? Because, so I'm making the product of some Heaviside function with some term that is linear in the input. So the product is going to look like this, some flat, and then you have a threshold, and then you evolve linearly. This is a ReLU, okay, so in this direction. So essentially you have a ReLU inside this loss, and this is very useful to have such a simple form for the reward when we're gonna want to do constrained reward optimization. So the idea here is that this function is gonna optimize this weight in order to maximize its reward. So this can be used in different settings, depending on the neuromodulator, supervised or unsupervised. But here, essentially, I wanted just to illustrate the connection you have between the reward and the update rule that allows to update the weights. And that's essentially the way, you know, if you have some insight about how weights are updated in a network or should be updated, You can look at this relationship between finding like the optimal reward function to get the particular algorithm that you need to update the weights. So if I do reward maximization, I'm going to maximize my reward with respect to W, and I can typically add some metabolic constraint in neural network because spikes are costly. Okay, spikes are costly, and that's why, in particular, we can measure our brain activity with functional magnetic resonance imaging and the BOLD signal. Because when a lot of neurons are spiking, they essentially consume oxygen. So you need more oxygen and you need to burn more calories in general. So it's important for a biological network to be metabolically efficient. And so typically this constraint avoids that the activity increases endlessly. And also, of course, it has a benefit that we cannot see here because this is a static model. The benefit is to ensure stability. So there are pathologies like epilepsy where spiking activity goes crazy and generates instability at the level of the network and prevents our brains to function normally. Okay, so if I want to optimize this, I can essentially implement, so you see this reward here is different from this shape. So this is a general shape of the reward for one sample. Now you can compute the sum of the rewards for different samples. And each time you get a new sample, essentially your reward is updated. And you can use stochastic gradient descent in order to optimize such rewards. So for each sample, I'm going to optimize essentially W by moving into the direction of the gradient with respect to W of this quantity, that is the quantity for one single sample, so that I can update my W at each time step. And so in artificial neural networks, typically it's a modification of that is done, is batch normalization when you want to process in parallel several samples. But essentially at the level of biological networks, we typically cannot gather samples before processing them. We process samples one at a time. So you see that if I look at the gradient of that with respect to W, this is not a linear function, not fully, but it has some linear component here. But this is a Heaviside function. So essentially, this is going to be proportional to the derivative of the hinge loss, or the derivative of the relu. And the derivative of the relu is going to be a hinge loss. Okay, so the derivative is going to be either 1 if the neuron is spiking, or 0 if the neuron is not spiking, multiplied by some extra terms. So here, from the gradient ascent of this reward function, you can get an update rule here. For each weight, and WJ is essentially the synaptic weight of for the input neuron J. Okay? So this update can be proportional to an alpha that is your reflecting your learning rate. And here you get that the number neuromodulatory part of your reward is still preserved here and is multiplied by this quantity that tell you, okay, actually it's a form of Hebbian rule in the sense that my weight is going to be updated only if I'm outputting a spike, so y equals 1, and I have an input spike on this input neuron. And then I updated with this reward, and otherwise I do nothing. And again, so depending on the reward, you can do supervised or unsupervised learning. In a supervised learning setting, you could have like negative or positive rewards, such that you can either decrease or increase the weight of the incoming neuron. Okay, so this is one field that is connecting machine learning and neuroscience. Is essentially the art to describe learning and plasticity in the brain based on objective functions. And this is essentially the very principle of machine learning is to design objective functions in order to do learning. But of course, we are able to understand the purpose of an objective function. It's less obvious to understand the purpose of weight update algorithm, and this is typically what is observed in experimental neuroscience and not the objective function. So big thing would be, what is the objective function that the brain optimizes? Is there one? And the second thing is, because it's not obvious, and I will talk about it tomorrow, I think, it's not obvious if you have a given objective function how to compute a weight update for each neuron that is useful. Okay, it's related to this credit assignment problem because you have some limitation in the mechanisms you can use to update the weights. So, for example, I will talk, I think, tomorrow about this debate whether the brain is implementing backpropagation or not. Backpropagation is a workhorse of deep learning, but backpropagation has some aspects that are non-biological, essentially. All right. So, yeah. I think, yeah, I will skip this, but essentially, once you have this shape for learning algorithm, essentially, you can study what are the implications of the learning rule and the reward, and show, for example, that the norm of the synaptic weights is gonna control essentially the spiking probability. So you can see how this norm of the synaptic weights act as a regularizer for the behavior of the neuron, for example. And also in this paper, we have some learning bounds that you can derive for such algorithm. But I'm gonna wrap up here the first investigation of the connection between artificial neural networks and brains. So, yeah, maybe let me skip this. Yeah, let me still talk about a bit about networks. One difference, so we saw like some differences, especially at the level of a single neurons. One difference at the level of the networks is that in artificial neural networks, you have a lot of freedom in the way you can pick your weights. So typically, one single neuron can have both positive and negative weights in relation to other its output neurons. In biological networks, this is the job of positive and negative weights is well divided between neurons. So you have the so-called excitatory neurons that have only positive weights. So they tend to push the what we call the the output neurons, they tend to push them to spike, and the inhibitory neurons, they tend to prevent them to spike. Okay, so you have this very clear structure in terms of the organization of the connectivity matrix between say two layers of field forward biological network. Okay, and one extra sophistication, and to some extent, I mean, you can have such architecture in a recurrent neural network, artificial recurrent neural networks, but it's also at the core, essentially, of the organization of the cortex, If you look at a small piece of cortex, you have so-called microcircuits that organize the connectivity between different types of neurons. So one division of the types of neuron is excitatory and inhibitory, but of course there are also like many more subtleties in this division. But typically you have this control, you can implement such control circuits where inhibitory activity, so inhibitory neurons, affect excitatory neurons either through feedback. So excitatory neurons get an input and they start to spike. And then these spikes, they are received by inhibitory neurons and they can then moderate by feedback the activity of excitatory neurons. So another type of circuit is a feed-forward inhibition where both excitatory and inhibitory neurons, they get the same input. And when this input is too strong, essentially, inhibitory neurons are going to also control the activity of excitatory neurons. So of course, like these two types of circuits have different dynamical properties, and they can be used to adjust the activity in a particular region of the brain, and they can implement some gain control, right? So for example, you can imagine that if we perceive the world with quite strong robustness to contrast, so I can see this, if we switch off the light, if we close the window, to some extent, I will have a remarkable stability in my perception. And such regulatory circuits, they can help essentially maintaining the same level of activity of a particular brain region, irrelevant from the strength of the input. Okay, so those circuits are very useful, and it's also like a huge field essentially to characterize how these circuits work. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about visual perception. Okay, so let's look at the organization of biological brains at a larger level, and especially in relation to one particular function of our brains, which is visual perception. And to some extent, you could say that this is the field that is the most closely related to recent development. Well, there's also, okay, there are different fields, but that one is strongly related to the recent developments in deep learning. So, in a nutshell, the information reaches our brains, the visual information, through the eyes. There are actually fibers from the left and right eye that are crossing before reaching different thalamic nuclei. So this is a small structure below the neocortex. And from this region, they are forwarded to the cortex that processes the information through different successive regions. Okay, so this is called bottom-up processing. So essentially, activity is processed in a hierarchy. The processing of incoming information is hierarchically organized. In terms of maybe something that is important, the left and right eye, due to this crossing here, if you look at it later, it's implemented such that they reach both sides of our brain. So this is a top view of the brain, right? So activity of both eyes reach both sides of the brain. So you have information for both sides on each side, and the difference between the left and right side of the brain is that they encode different parts of the visual field. Okay, so on the left brain you will have one part, one half, and on the right you will have the other half. So this is kind of a funny thing that actually can be used to study consciousness, but our perception of the two sides of the visual field is first divided between our two hemispheres. Okay? And within a single hemisphere, we especially in with functional magnetic resonance imaging, people were able to characterize specialization of different successive areas. So this is V1, the primary visual cortex, where sensory input arises from the thalamus. And here, essentially, this organization is preserved for a while. The center of the visual field is in a particular location, and there is more density of receptor for this center, like the fovea. And here you have periphery, essentially information about the periphery of the visual field is on the sides. Information is forwarded to V2, V3, and like successive regions. And what's interesting, for example, is after, like, the more you go up in the hierarchy, the more you're specialized, and you find regions that are sensitive to particular features and even like symbolic values, essentially, of the visual stimuli. So here, for example, these regions react to objects, and this part of the region reacts to faces, okay? Object, faces, and also places. So here, for example, this region is sensitive to places. So to some extent, the center of the fovea and this region, you know, they're gonna specialize in encoding the object. And these things encoded by the periphery, also they can be associated more with the background. What is essentially the environment where the object is. And so, of course, this organization bears quite a bit of similarity, and it's also due to the fact that this inspired, to some extent, this work, with multi-layer deep convolutional neural networks, where essentially you have first, like, some low-level feature extractors applied to the image, and then you get more and more high-level representation to finally extract some typically qualitative information about what or where is an object in an image. Okay, so and you can look at this review essentially to look at the current research in terms of paralleling the structure of the feed-forward structure of the visual system and the visual pathways. So here you have like a simplified description of this this pathway. This is called the Ventras pathway that is involved into like object recognition, detection. And essentially, people try to exploit modeling using machine learning in order to better understand the processing of visual information across this pathway in biological brains. And you have some clear parallels between like the functional form of these convolutional layers and the actual circuits in biological brains. So it's a sophisticated system that we describe here, but it also can get confused very easily. I mean, maybe not very easily, okay. So if you look at this picture, I don't know if you saw this picture before. So you see, what do you see? Do you observe an issue with this picture? So, who sees a young woman? Okay. Who sees an old woman? Ah, okay. It's quite 50-50. I never made this statistic actually before. So it's actually a postcard. You see, German postcard from 1888. So this wine, this was not a long time ago. And yeah, so it was after used by a journalist. You can check Wikipedia. He made a drawing out of it. And he called it "My Wife and My Mother-in-Law," which I guess, yeah, there's some joke about it. So this is like a typical example of an ambiguous picture. Our brain can switch from one interpretation of this image to another interpretation of this image. This has been exploited also by artists. For example, here you can see, like, you can have like essentially a coarse level of interpretation when you see nicely a face, but if you look at the details, you realize that this is a scene that has nothing to do with that. So you can play essentially with different sensory cues and information in the image to generate some ambiguity in our perception. And this is not really surprising that we encounter this kind of phenomena, because the problem of vision, and that has been known since the very beginning, it's solves an Ilpos problem, okay? Is that we get a 2D representation of the world, but we want to infer a 3D configuration. And of course, there are many potential solutions for this problem, and our brains have to make some choices, have to choose some priors in order to interpret the sensory input and to get a useful interpretation that will be predictive in the real world. And there's an interesting parallel with current work on deep learning, especially the field of adversarial attacks. So, in a nutshell, adversarial attacks, the idea is that you can take an original picture that is correctly classified by typically VGG or like any like well-performing deep learning classifier. You add a very, very small amount of noise, but of course this noise is chosen carefully. Such that when you add it to the input picture, you see no difference. I mean, a human will not see a difference, but while these pictures are correctly interpreted by the deep learning algorithm, these pictures are interpreted as ostrich. Okay? They are all classified as ostrich. This is an ostrich, according to this algorithm. So, well, that poses some issues, especially like people think of putting deep learning algorithm in cars, okay, for self-driving cars. And of course, there is the question whether you want to be transported by such a car if it can make such mistakes, okay? So we will talk about it more in detail tomorrow. But here is an interesting example because somehow people have been more and more capable of generating a robust adversarial example. So in this paper, similar last year, they managed to optimize even like a 3D object such that it gets badly classified. So as a rifle, this tortoise is classified as a rifle robustly by a deep learning algorithm. So. Yeah, maybe. Let's see. Okay, so do you see anything? No. Ah. Okay, I think, I guess. Ah, okay, you see this video? Okay. So you have this object and you see the classification outcome. This is rifle here. Typically, so when you move around this object, it's consistently classified as a rifle. And to some extent, I don't talk about it now, and occlusion doesn't change anything. This is, Rifle, okay. It's related to some idea that is ongoing, like in the field, that mostly deep learning classifiers use the texture information to take decision. And so if you can play a bit with the texture of the object, you might able to induce such confusion. Okay, so here's another example of confusion that you can have. So what do you see? I mean, okay, I see it differently than when I had it on my screen. So these lines, right, they seem like there are some curvature. Do you see curvature? Yeah? Okay, that's good. So, but actually, if you take an individual example here, you can see clearly that there is absolutely no curvature. These lines are completely straight. Okay? So this is actually the colleague that showed me like such example. He's working on adversarial attacks to say, well, actually it's a typical example where you change only a few pixels, typically, and you can induce a lot of confusion in the perception, okay? And these few pixels, so I mean, difficult to go into exact mechanism that do that, but typically I think like those pixels here, black pixels, at the coarse level, this change essentially the volume of this square, such that the coarse level interpretation will say, well, actually these squares in the middle, they are bigger, so it's impossible that I have like straight lines. Okay, so I have to, at a high level, to consider that those lines are not straight. Okay, so our brains is constantly doing this kind of computation to help us doing inference in the real world. But of course, because we are solving a difficult problem, we are not able, I mean, we can get confused by some examples that are, to some extent, carefully chosen, okay? Actually, this type of perceptual phenomena, they are used to study consciousness. So consciousness is a very debated term, even in neuroscience, but you can call it perception. So maybe I go quickly to this slide. There's a difference between sensation and perception, especially in psychology and neuroscience. So sensation is essentially the information given that by the photons that hit your retina. Okay. What we see is not what we sense with our retina. What we see is what we perceive, and typically that means that our brains are doing some interpretation of the sensation. And this is why you can have this kind of phenomena. This is not exactly what we perceive, what we sense. Perception involves a lot of high-level computation. So this can be used to study consciousness in the sense like what I perceive is actually reflecting what I'm conscious about, right? And you can induce, you can disentangle essentially sensation and perception, so consciousness, with relatively simple protocols. And one protocol is binocular rivalry. So binocular rivalry, you just have to project two different pictures on each eye, okay? And what our brain is going to do is not to merge the two, typically. You can also have that in some conditions, but what it's gonna do is gonna make a choice. It's gonna choose either left eye or the right eye. But actually, at some point, it's gonna change its mind. And it's gonna, if you were perceiving this red thing, at some point, your perception is gonna switch to the green thing. And this is actually a well-studied phenomenon that this perception switches with some statistical regularity, actually. And you can use essentially this switch information in order to study which neurons in the brain reflect sensation, so essentially what hits my retina and what's in each eye, and which is reflecting consciousness, meaning just like what I perceive. And one way to do it is was done actually in this seminal paper. You can use gratings. What's called gratings is instead of these two colorful images, you have gratings translating in different directions, either up and down. And you can do that with humans or with animals, and you don't need you get directly an information about the perception of the animal, of the human, by monitoring the eye saccades. Because when you follow an image that is going up like this, typically your eyes are going to saccade, they are going to follow the movement, and then switch quickly back, and follow, and back, and follow, and back. So from this information of eye movement, you can get directly what the subject is perceiving, either going down or going up. So in monkey, it was possible to show that although there's a lot of neurons in the cortex that are sensitive just to the information on the left eye, on the right eye, there are some neurons like this one that consistently report the perception. So if you look at the activity when you have a non-ambiguous percept with the two eyes where the two eyes are simulated, then you have like a strong activity with up, and no activity, almost no activity going down. And now if you put an ambiguous percept, and you can infer the perception as going up here, going up here and going down here, then you can see that this neuron is also going to be sensitive just to the percept and not the individual information of each eye. So that's the way people study consciousness. Yevgeny, how much time?
So I should have 2 minutes.
Okay. Okay, so maybe I'm just wrapping up this one application of machine learning to consciousness. So here you have a rivalry protocol. So that was performed in our lab. So there was two ambiguous percepts. One is the face of a monkey, so it's a monkey experiment. And one is some artificial image. And essentially the question was, in a particular region of the brain, which is called the prefrontal cortex, my colleagues wanted to address what is the content essentially encoded in the neurons in this part of the cortex. And essentially they have a lot of unit recordings, but typically, you can look at particular features by saying, okay, I know there is some feature in the image, like the conscious content or the sensation. I can use this information to classify in a supervised way which neurons are reacting to which aspect of the stimulus. Now, if you want to address more generally the question, in this brain region, that is a very high-level region, okay, involving consciousness, perception, and different aspects of decision. Actually, the neurons that I found related to the stimulus, there's a percentage, but it's not so much. So what are the other neurons do? Okay, if we want really, if we are serious about like addressing like brain function, we should not only like report what is the activity of a few neurons that we know are correlated to the stimulus, but what are also the rest, what is the rest doing? And so you can use unsupervised learning techniques to address this question. So there's like 500 units to characterize that were not associated essentially to the stimulus. And this particular protocol was used to address consciousness, because people believe in neuroscience that to understand consciousness, you can use a paradigm where you can just ask a subject to watch something without giving a task. And because the subject doesn't have to do a task, then the activity that you record is not affected by the intention of the subject, but just by its perception. And essentially, like, then the question is, what is then encoded by these other neurons? If there is no task, there is no intention, only perception. And so what we use is actually to characterize coarsely the content, the information content of those neurons for which we don't know what they encode, is to use a matrix factorization that's actually still like a topic that is active, very active in machine learning, and to say, okay, I can build a matrix with the responses of all my units, all my spikes. So one direction is the units, and the other direction is their temporal response, okay? So you can make the histogram of the spike rate of each unit when they respond to a stimulus. And so essentially, one axis reflects time, the other axis reflects units, and we can do a non-negative matrix factorization to try to find a sparse representation of this population activity. And say, okay, non-negative matrix factorization is going to allow to decompose this matrix into a product of two low-rank matrices that are also positive, so that I can still interpret essentially my activity as the spiking of some units. And when we do this decomposition, so of course we have to optimize for like the number, the optimal number of components and these kind of things. We can find different components that are present in this matrix, and essentially reflects canonical responses of this population of neurons. And interestingly, what we found is that most of the neurons in this region of the cortex, a lot of them, they are simply monitoring time. Okay, so you see that because the response of this, the canonical response of this neuron, so these are different conditions, the four points. You see that there are neurons that respond at the beginning of a trial, at the middle of a trial, or at the end of the trial. So that the result of this was essentially that while monitoring, studying consciousness, there's a lot of neurons in this region that actually simply monitor the evolution of time, essentially. So the phase of the task. You say, okay, something is happening. I am at the beginning, I am the middle, I am at the end. So essentially, it was important for the field because people have to be aware that when they study consciousness, actually, the result can be confounded by such activities of the neurons. Okay, so yeah, next time I will talk about more causality and different aspects related to interpreting brain activity. Okay.